Hi, I put together a quick presentation about the bump at the end of the bridge. Went kind of old school with a PowerPoint presentation. Did you know the bump at the end of the bridge costs about $100 million a year in maintenance costs? And I believe people think that it costs another $100 million a year to pay for the vehicles and the drivers that have been injured from the bump at the end of the bridge. What causes the bump? Well, let's talk a little bit about bridges. So this is a precast, pre-tensioned concrete beam bridge. There's a couple, and I designed actually one of these a long time ago. And if you look at them, this is an abutment, this is an abutment, this is a pier, this is a pier. This is the approach pavement, this is the abutment, and I want to talk a little bit about piles. These are all piles that are showing up on this bridge. And I have quite a few of them here, but let's talk about piles. So I'm going to go to this abutment, and right now all there are vertical piles here, and that typically means that they only carry loads in this direction. It could be they hold it down, it could be that they hold it up, but they really don't resist this kind of movement too much. It's an oversimplification, but that's what a single pile does, right? They can't resist lateral loads. So let's go over to the piers, and I know this is a lot of piles. I had a really sandy soil that I had to put into it. And if you know anything about piles, these are friction piles. And that means that friction of the soil on the pile surface is what gives it its holding capability. Well, you can see this has battered piles. So when you have battered piles, so this pile straight up and down looks like a force like that. If you have a battered pile, it can have a force like this, or it can hold it down. But if you do it into components, what do you get? You get this force right here, which is a lateral force. So it can resist movement. So typically, if you see battered piles, this pier is not meant to move at all. All right, let's go back to the presentation. Start it back up again. So here's your typical situation. You got a pre-stressed beam bridge, concrete beam bridge. The deck, the beam, all part of this integral abutment. They're all cast together. Approach pavement, cars driving over top. What happens is this bridge can move. This abutment can move. And it starts to consolidate all this soil, causing problems down here. You might get some loss of soil, some compaction. And that affects the approach pavement. It doesn't give it any more support anymore. So what happens is the pavement sinks. Usually it doesn't have any steel in it, so it breaks. And the soil compresses, and it causes a bump at the end of the road, right? A bump at the end of the road right there. And it's a bit problematic for drivers, not the greatest animation. So let's look at an integral abutment for a pre-stressed, pre-cast concrete bridge. If you look at it, the whole thing is cast together. Here's the beam. Here's the deck, the roadway that people drive on. This over here is called a paving notch that holds the approach pavement up. And a single vertical pile, and we talked about that, that allows it to move back and forth at expansion and contraction with temperature forces. Another kind of abutment is a stub abutment. And you can see right off the bat that I have a battered pile. So that means it's not going to move. It's got two sets of piles to hold it up. But with the battered pile, it's meant to stay in place. The approach pavement comes in like this, and it's a little hard to see, but this purple piece here is a piece of steel that holds this approach pavement, ties it into this stub abutment. What moves are the beams. The beams move, and the expansion's taken all up here with an expansion joint on the inside of the stub abutment. So the stub abutment doesn't move, the beams move. There's another kind of bridge called a continuous concrete slab bridge. And again, it's one piece, and the deck, this part right here that you drive on, is just a thick piece of concrete, something you'd see on a road or your driveway or anything like that. It's just all cast together. It's just one solid chunk of concrete. Now the approach pavement comes in like this, and this is also a movable abutment. It will go back and forth. It will move back and forth because there's only a single pile. It doesn't resist it from moving back and forth. Now there's one more called a semi-integral movable abutment. And what does it look like? Well, this piece right here does not move. The column, footing, usually battered piles, this doesn't move. The rest of it does move. And as you can see, all of it, the deck of the bridge, the approach pavement, this big hunk of concrete at the back, this steel beam or concrete beam, but in this case it's showing a steel beam, all of it moves. Now, what's the advantage of this system? Well, the advantage is the water doesn't drain down onto the bridge abutment. It's carried off the bridge. If some water does come down, it comes down like this, goes around here, sort of sneaks around, hits this prefabricated material, maybe goes through the drain, weep hole, and away. So the advantage of this is you get a semi-integral abutment that takes the water off the deck. It doesn't come down and affect the abutment. That's also a problem with stub bridges, right? Your joint fails, all the water will start dripping on all your supports in a stub abutment. So that's how it moves. It's one giant piece. And you can see it. There's steel from the approach pavement, right? This is the approach pavement. It's tied together, and there's steel from the deck going into. Well, that's a lot to learn about bridges. What else do you know about bridges? Well, some of the ways you can fix it, and this is really low-tech animation, is you can drill cores into the concrete, and you can inject epoxy to lift the approach pavement. And what that does is it lifts it back into place, and you can drive on it again. Another way to do it is actually build a doubly reinforced approach pavement section. So this top one is a precast pretensioned concrete beam bridge. Let's go through it. So this is the joint. This is where all the expansion and compaction is going to take place. So this is moving the abutment, and it's squeezing the joint right here. This pavement is not going to go anywhere because they put a lug on it. So it sticks in the soil. There'll be soil on either side, just holding this pavement in place. They made it doubly reinforced, though. So if there was no soil underneath it, it's just like having another bridge. So if the soil failed, let's say it failed like this and there was an opening right here. Well, this bridge is designed, this approach pavement is designed as a bridge. They'll say, well, for this length, it has to be a bridge. And that's what the doubly reinforced steel would be designed for. So for a PPC bridge, this is what you'd do. You'd have a joint here. Now for a stub abutment, remember, it doesn't move at all. So you can tie the approach pavement to it. You're going to do the same thing, put double reinforced steel in, because you still might get bouncing on this pavement that makes the soil go like this. And you don't want it to break and make a bump at the end. So you double reinforce it. You design it for some length and say this is going to be a mini bridge if the soil gets compressed or wanders away in some way. These are just a couple of variations on it. Really, the only difference is if you're using an old pre-stressed beam bridge, and they might have a variable notch height. So this paving notch might be deeper than before. So you just have a little bit of variable depth at the end here, concrete. But essentially, it's the same thing. There's a lug. The approach pavement's not going to move. All of the compression, expansion is taking place right here in the joint. Same thing down here. This is a stub abutment. You tie it to it. It just has a paving notch that's lower than typical. So a pre-stressed beam bridge, typically 200 to 600 feet. It's probably the most popular bridge in America. Typically not attached to the approach pavement. And again, the joint is where all the expansion contraction takes place. The slab bridge, typically less than 200 feet. This is also a very popular bridge because it's very low maintenance. Typically attached to the approach pavement. You can see it's attached to the end of the bridge. Why is this? Well, a precast bridge usually has a long distance to push. So what happens on a precast bridge is you fix a pier typically, and what that means is you put some battered piles on it so it doesn't move. And so the thermal expansion and contraction is going to go from this fixed point. It's going to push on this, this is going to move back and forth, and then it's going to push on this section and back and forth. You usually don't fix two piers, so this pier might have some movable supports on it. Now, if it has to push this length and this approach pavement was attached as well, it would have to push this much concrete. And it gets to be a little much for a concrete beam bridge. You can cause some breakup because it's hard to push all this approach pavement. Down on the slab bridge, usually you fix something like a pier so it doesn't move. But look at the shorter distance. So you can attach this and it will push this whole section at one time because it's all attached. And what that does is it takes the water way off the bridge and into a joint further down here so that this part of the bridge doesn't get affected. So also with a pre-stressed beam, you might have more lanes, you know, bigger bridge, six lanes, eight lanes. There's a lot of concrete to push. Big skews, if you have a 45 degree skew, it's really difficult to push all that approach pavement on a big skew. Slab bridges are shorter, stronger in a way, allows water to flow further from the abutment. And we talked about that. But both are movable bridges, but handled differently, right? So you can see my little animations going. There's the joint right there closing and opening. Down here, it's pushing the approach pavement. I don't know why I put this slide in, but I had to do something. Now, the slab bridge, we just talked about it. You can see it's tied to the pavement notch, and it's got this concrete, again, double reinforcement. So if it's bouncing, somebody's bouncing trucks here and the soil compresses, well, I've got a mini bridge in this approach pavement. So I've designed for no soil underneath it, bearing here, maybe bearing here, pretending it's a bridge. So I have soil right here and this empty void I have to design this approach pavement for. The second thing about it is you put in a sleeper slab, and that's what this is, a little further away. In this case, about 20 feet. This is where all the expansion and contraction takes place at a joint here. All the water comes off the bridge down to this joint or to the sides if it has some slope to some drains on either side of this. The sleeper slab allows all this. If you have problems, like lots of water in here, you know, this is easier to replace than to replace the abutment of a bridge. And just for to compare it, here's a precast pretension concrete beam bridge. It's a lot to say. And it's not tied, right? But it doesn't move the approach pavement. Again, all the compression and expansion takes place right here. So that's a quick overview of everything. I hope it made sense. It's kind of a low-tech presentation. Leave some comments